This film is about a legendary man most people have never heard of. Salvador Dalí described him as an immensely rich English poet. He was also the foremost early collector of surrealist art. Decried as autocrat and madman, he is equally relished by those of us who know him as the last of the great eccentrics. Until recently, West Dean in Sussex, an estate comprising a village, 11 farms and 2,000 acres of woodland, belonged to a man called Edward James. For those who live here, even those who've met him, Edward James remains an enigma shrouded in outrageous myth and rumour. On leaving England in 38, he cut himself off from the many painters and writers he had entertained at West Dean House. John Betjeman wrote wistfully of his vanished Oxford contemporary, "The sun that shines on Edward James shines also down on me." They tell me he's in Mexico. They will not give me his address. But if he sees this book, he'll know I do not value him the less. For art is long and life must end, my earlier publisher and friend.
I always feel a bit like the Wandering Jew because of taxation problems. Always having to move one place to another, building houses and travelling and helping other artists, which if I had had to earn a living, I couldn't have. All creative people work from their subconscious outwards, and intellectuals work from their intellect inwards, you see. I'm not an intellectual at all. In fact, most intellectuals resent me. They all realize I'm not one of them, and it's quite nasty. To them, I'm sort of an overgrown child. And I always try, and now that I'm old, saying I'm in my second childhood, you must excuse me. But of course, that's not strictly true, because I've never grown out of my first childhood.
The Sunday market at Ilitla, 400 miles north of Mexico City. Typical of other rural villages in Mexico, except that the villagers tend to be more prosperous, the direct result of the rich Englishman who has made his home among them.
I can't buy any pants. Nobody's as fat as I am in this town. The waist size is all too small. Well, there's a hell of a hat.
Although he's been around for some 30 years, he remains here, as at West Dean, the object of unending speculation and curiosity. Besides adopting an entire Mexican family, Edward James is the largest employer of local labor, recruited to help him realize his architectural dreams and follies in the neighboring jungle. The Mexicans are undaunted by such eccentricities. Their unpredictable temperament is well suited to Edward's own.
I've always been very unpunctual, not meaning to be, you know, but felt guilty about it, and slightly illogical. And it was such bliss to come to a country in which, by comparison to the inhabitants, I was extremely punctual and extremely logical. So it sort of got rid of the guilt that I was always made to feel in England by turning up 20 minutes late. Here people are 3 hours late, and I'm thinking of it. So I felt, you know, that I didn't no longer feel guilty of being haphazard.
Rare pheasants and a variety of exotic birds preen and scream in the woods surrounding Edward's other English home, which he's visited only rarely during the last 40 years. Monkton is a looking-glass house of surrealist pictures and priceless objects. Edward James redesigned it in the 30s to reflect his sense of poetic humour, his empathy with the visionary world of the surrealists. The pillars are fiberglass palm trees, the drainpipes are bamboos, the windowsills support plaster drapes, all contrary to the spirit of a house designed originally by Lutyens.
If I have any criticism to make of Lutyens, he rather went into being cottagey. I wanted to get away from that cottagey look. I decided to make this house comfortable so I'd have somewhere just large enough for me and not as big as West Dean. But I had to make it warm, so we had the walls padded not because I was going to have a throw a fit and bang my head against it, although it looks like a padded cell, padded and buttoned to keep it cozy and warm.
The bathroom is of alabaster, and behind the translucent walls is inserted two nightlights, a blue moon and a red sun. The motif on the stair carpet was inspired by the wet footprints of a long-dead Irish wolfhound. The sofas, upholstered to simulate Mae West's lips, are based on an image of Salvador Dalí's.
Now, in here is a very different story. Here is a lady who is rather indignant because she was woken from a 2-year sleep rather rudely before I could stop it. I meant to have her woken by the sound of flutes. I'm very sorry you were so rudely disturbed. Please don't look so cross. Now, she's going to be put in a large case of perspex, five-sided, outside, and she's going to be hanging over the front of the house with a light above her and music coming out. I think I'm going to have a musical box made with a very special Mayan tune, which will play from time to time when the clock strikes. If I'm a surrealist, it's not because I got linked with a movement, it's because I was born one. A great number of people are surrealists without ever having heard of the movement. But it is people who were close to their subconscious. The world is not completely logical all the time. They make the illogical logical, and they make it more vivid than life, in the way that dreams can sometimes be more vivid than actual actuality. When I was a child, I used to have the most extraordinary surrealist fantasies. I think one of the reasons that my fantasy was developed so intensely was that I was forced to rest, quite unnecessarily, when I should have been allowed to run around in the garden. I was made to sleep in my perambulator, and I couldn't sleep. Also, I wasn't allowed up in the morning. I remember in Scotland, in a wonderful fine day in August, and the sun pouring through the blinds at 7, I wanted to get out of my little bed, but I was hemmed in by big brass rails, and run out into the garden and down to the beach. But I wasn't allowed to until Nanny woke up, which wasn't until 8:30. So I would have from 7 till 8:30, in which I'd have to invent a world, and therefore all my blankets became a flying city, and I made domes out of the pillows, and I would get under and imagine that I was in a series of halls, and this was Aladdin's palace flying over the world.
Much of Edward's childhood was spent at West Dean, the great house which his American father bought with some of the vast fortune inherited and increased from railroads and copper mines. Mr. Willie James's wealth and culture ensured his rapid integration into the English aristocracy. Edward's mother, Mrs. Willie James, was a famous Edwardian hostess, entertaining the nobility at West Dean on a lavish scale.
Weekend parties, 30 people was quite a common number of people. And seemed we had royalty all the time. It sounds awfully snobbish, but there were as much as 3 kings on one occasion. Of course, one had been dethroned, so perhaps he wasn't a pucker king at the time. It was King Manuel of Portugal. The other was Alfonso of Spain. The other was Edward VII.
The Jameses had 5 children, 4 daughters. Then, after a 7-year hiatus, Edward, the son and heir. If his mother's feelings for Edward were short of indifference, their relationship was certainly not close.
I remember being brought down ceremoniously to say goodnight to her. She wasn't like an ordinary mother who put you to bed or fed you and things. My nurse was my real mother. My nurse was warm and comfy and soft. And my mother had very, very tight whalebone corsets, looked very beautiful, was covered with jewels, it seemed, all the time. She had things on top of things, which was the Edwardian fashion. She would have sables with double palmer violets pinned on them. And the sables had horrid little heads that showed they'd once been live animals. My mother was so distant from my children. There's a story about her which is probably apocryphal, but it sums up the attitude. She was heard calling up the main staircase one day, "Nanny, Nanny, I want one of the children to take to church." And my nurse replied, "Which one, madam?" She said, "The one that goes best with my blue dress."
His father died when Edward was only five, and the memory of his love for him will not allow him to countenance the ancient rumour, fanned by Belloc's poem, "Mrs. James Will Entertain a King," that he was really the illegitimate son of Edward VII, officially his godfather. But his own theories, based on private evidence, are no less contentious.
You see, the king was constantly here, and naturally gossip went around that he was my mother's lover. Well, I know that is completely untrue. The king knew that my mother was his daughter, and therefore, where any bastard blood came in, it wasn't in that generation, it was in my grandmother's generation. I think if the truth had been told and been admitted that she was the daughter of Edward VII and not the mistress, it would have been made much more sense, much more wholesome and truthful too. They didn't like the truth very much in those days. They thought the truth was always in bad taste. I remember Lady Cunard saying to me when I was 16 at a tea party, she asked me some question, "Where is so-and-so?" So I told her where so-and-so was and how he was, and evidently I shouldn't have answered the question truthfully. So she said to me, she had a very funny voice, Lady Cunard, she talked like this, she said, "Edward, the trouble about you is you will go around telling the truth. Now society is built upon a lie, and if you go around telling the truth the way you do, you won't be received in decent houses." Which I thought very profound.
At Oxford, while indulging a growing interest in the arts, he chose to flaunt his money with ostentatious flamboyance. He drove a Rolls-Royce, piloted his own aeroplane, and his rooms were lined with velvet and limned in purple and gold. His friend, John Betjeman, encouraged him to write poetry, and it was Betjeman's own early verses which led to the founding of the James Press.
We collected all his poems together, and he gave it the title of Mount Zion, or In Touch with the Infinite. And there was a picture, circa 1900, of a lady holding a telephone, which suggests that she was in touch with the infinite. And all the paper was pink and yellow inside. And he supervised the typesetting. I then thought I would do a book of my own. So far, so glad. And it was a book about the planet Venus. And it was beautifully illustrated by a boy called Edward Carrick, with a picture on every page, and I made the full stops green, which amused Betjeman very much.
The next volume was the title of Edward James's own first book of poems, compiled soon after leaving Oxford.
It was very beautifully illustrated by Rex Whistler, and it was done in collar type, which is a form of photographing on gelatin, so it looks like steel engravings, but even more delicate.
Rex Whistler, a frequent visitor to Edward's London house, was just one of many aspiring artists commissioned by this inordinately rich young man. At 24, Edward James got married to Tilly Losh, a popular actress and dancer who stayed at West Dean several times during their formal two-year courtship. The marriage turned out to be the most traumatic 3 years of Edward's life.
First time I caught sight of Tilly, she was in a review called This Year of Grace. I was bowled over by Tilly's appearance, and so I thought Tilly must have the most beautiful soul because I associated her with the music and with the choreography.
¶¶ dancer of humble Viennese origin, marriage to a rich upper-class Englishman offered a solution verging on the cliché. But it wasn't until the Hawaiian honeymoon that it became clear that Tilly had married under the misapprehension that Edward was homosexual, that it wasn't to be a marriage in name only. Admittedly, the groom here appears rather more interested in the flora, but he was obsessively in love with Tilly. He tried to keep her with him by showering her with extravagant presents, but when she finally left him, he embarked on the most grandiose scheme to win her back. As a setting for her talents, he financed an entire season of ballet in Paris. Balanchine was to direct the Russian troupe, formerly of Diaghilev's company. The Ballets of 33 was a no-expense-spared project for which James commissioned the most elaborate sets and costumes and original scores from fashionable composers like Milo and Sergei, and with one motif only, to persuade his wife to return to him.
I wanted a whole night of ballet, rather like Diaghilev's famous Sleeping Princess, and I thought it was a very good way to get Tilly to come back to me, because I still wanted her very much. So I said, would she come and star in my ballets? And Tilly came back, and a ballet was done particular for her called Errant.
Performed to the music of Schubert's Wanderer Sonata, Errant was carefully tailored to highlight Tilly's special talents. But the most interesting item in the repertoire, based on an original idea of Edward James himself, was a ballet operetta in which a singer and a dancer represented the two sides of a dual personality. It was called Anna Anna, or The Seven Deadly Sins. Lottie Lenya co-starred with Tilly, and Edward persuaded Brecht and Kurt Weill to leave an increasingly dangerous Germany to write what proved to be their last collaboration together.
Ach, ich sagte ihr oft, ohne Treue, bist du höchstens die Hälfte wert.
Yet in spite of Tilly's personal triumph in this and the other ballets, her husband's expansive gesture failed to melt her heart. The whole production moved to London, but Tilly was notable by her absence when the dancers were invited to weekend at West Dean. Tilly's contemptuous refusal to return to Edward despite the ballets turned his unrequited love to a bitter and resentful hatred. Divorce was inevitable, and Edward decided to fight it out. Evidence as to Tilly's many lovers offered a prurient feast for press and public, but for the protagonists it was a painful ordeal.
Nicht wahr, Anna? Ja, Anna.
Edward won so decisively that Tilly was ordered to pay costs, but it was a Pyrrhic victory. In the convention of the day, a gentleman didn't contest a divorce. Many of his friends, even his own family, turned against him.
I was very broken with grief after my wife left me, and also the exhaustion of the ballet, and a great loss of money, too. So I came back to this house alone, and the spring was so glorious at West Dean. This house was so full of treasures. The Georgian silver on the table was so beautiful. The flowers, I remember, they were nymph gladioli. The whole place was so rich with everything beautiful in creation that as I was beginning my dinner, I suddenly saw the room begin to spin. I looked up at the ceiling and I knew it was a projection of my own subconscious, but I saw a circle of all creation with a great light in the middle, and all the flowers and trees according to their genuses spread out, and all the animals according to their races and families all around this central light. And then it began to turn slowly and then faster and faster, and I heard the music of the last movement of Beethoven's Eroica Symphony, going faster and faster and faster, till suddenly it exploded in the sky. And I had to get up and go into the next room and kneel down, and Butler came in and didn't know where I'd gone to. So I then decided to write it as the story of the gardener.
The gardener who saw God, inspired by this and other personal experiences, was Edward's only serious and critically acclaimed novel. But his poetry, too, caught fire as a result of his suffering. Feeling betrayed by his family, exploited for his money, in despair of Tilly, whom he knew had aborted three of his children, he pictured himself a bitter old man standing guard over his treasures in a house that could only be West Dean.
The old lord hates his stable clock. He fears the tick-tock chattering flock of the world who's forgotten what he can't forget. He thinks of those people that makes him fret. He has chained his lodge gates with a heavy lock and sits and listens to no one knock, or the sighs of the populous tapestries in the passages that lead to the hall, through the withering threads of the lamp-dead house, and he mutters, it may be the mice he may mean, mutters, keep them out. My mother despised me, and I would blush, and that was so terribly long ago. My wife is still lovely, they say, but hush, she was lovely, 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 I know. They want my money, they want my blood. They've had my love, but they've spewed it out. They've envied my pictures, my farms, my stud. Keep them out, keep them out, keep them out. Let the unborn children tap against the blinds. Who cares a rap? Since children are doubtless thankless, then I'm glad I'm the loneliest of men. They, too, they would have made me bleed. Let me be glad that I did not breed. The small feet and the small hands, I can see them running all over my lands. I can see small heads nod in the corn, the curls of the children that never were born. Keep them out, keep them away. Or just let one or two in by day to come not too near for a little to play. You see, my child was born quite dead. The nursery musical box was broken. It was a bad omen, an ill token. It should have been mended, of course, he said. I would play that pingly musical box, but I hear that they call me the mad old fox. Close then the gate tight, and do not be seen, save by God who forgives. For I heard his tears splash on the pavement just when my fears were most terrible. Then I heard me shout, he will help you to keep them out. O God, who booms in the gabled church, dear God of psalms and bearded sighs, God of gold lakes and crowns, mine eyes are tired of their disillusion, tired.
What on earth is happening here?
Well, this is where your mother had some bitumastic tile.
In
1938, a disillusioned Edward James left England for the New World. He'd never lacked a pretext for travelling in Europe or America. This time it was to manage Dalí's exhibit at the New York World's Fair. He hadn't planned it consciously, but this proved the beginning of a semi-permanent exile from which he was finally to wrest a kind of happiness. Long before settling here in Mexico, Edward James' restless spirit led him to Hollywood. The strange vision at West Dean and his admiration for the work of a religious teacher, Gerald Hurd, roused his interest in mysticism. Like his friends, Aldous Huxley and Isherwood, he presented himself at Gerald Hurd's Hollywood retreat and became a disciple.
The first summer and winter in Beverly Hills, I really was terribly earnest. I became a vegetarian. I didn't go to movies. I refused all parties. And I tried very hard to meditate. And then I was hurt by Gerald Hurd, who assumed I was doing it all as a pose. It was just a gratuitous assumption that a so-called millionaire couldn't be seriously a mystic. He was just trying some other gimmick. So I started, little by little, giving up the vegetarianism and not going to cocktail parties because I felt let down. I went from having been on a very high moral level, really, to a rather low moral level, actually.
To jump from pious introspection to high life among movie stars and British expatriates, frittering away his time in restaurants, owning a house in Malibu as well as Hollywood, it was inevitable that Edward should again become disillusioned, this time with the double standards of the society he had joined, and to set out once more to seek his Shangri-La. The greatest part of Edward's love and loyalty is now directed towards his adopted family in Ilitla. He shares their house and has come to regard it as his real home.
No, yo estaba dormido. Por qué no se voló?
His old friendship with Plutarco Gastelum, a Mexican of Indian descent, his companion on many travels, later his manager, remained just as close when Plutarco married Marina and had four children, whom Edward now cares for as his own.
No puedo estar feliz porque está muy picoso.
Plutarco and Marina allow the less fortunate villagers to avail themselves of the facilities in by far the most luxurious house in Ilitla. Although entirely designed by Plutarco, it shows all the signs of his mentor's taste for the fantastic and bizarre. That Edward James has settled here was the result of several forays across the border from California.
I wanted a Garden of Eden set up where everything grew. I saw that Mexico was far more romantic and far more room than there is in crowded Southern California. So I bought two sleeping bags and I traveled around the country. Plutarco came along with me. And we used to sleep in the sleeping bags wherever we saw a turning that looked interesting. For instance, we saw that mountain, the Sierra up there, which is called the Mountain of the Horn in Nahuatl. So we said, we must try that. Then I took the car up to here and saw that Ilitla was a very beautiful place. And there wasn't anything as picturesque as Ilitla.
In the early days, Edward had a small house built by the waterfalls in the jungle, hoping to live a hermit's life with only his animals and wild parrots for company.
I didn't have a bathroom at all here in the house, not a tub, not even a shower. So I used the pools as my bathroom. And you really, it was quite hard to get to them, so I had to climb over rocks and along a very winding path through very thick bushes. So I thought I was completely secluded. And I was shampooing my hair one day, and I heard a rustling sound that I thought was the wind in the bamboos beginning. Then it sounded more like material. So I washed the soap out of my eyes and looked up, and I saw what I thought were about 12 penguins. And I was very surprised, penguins in the tropics. So I rubbed my eyes clear, and then to my horror, I was very astonished and embarrassed, there were 12 nuns. So I took a large leaf from one of those elephant ear leaves called a rehalgar, yeah? And I covered my nudity like Odysseus did when he met the princess Nausicaa after being shipwrecked in the seventh book of the Odyssey. And I said, I beg your pardon, que puede ofrecerle a ustedes? what can I offer you ladies? And they said, without the least hesitation, without appearing the least put out, can you build us a clinic for the poor and sick? So I said, oh yes, certainly, mother. I'll bid you a clinic if you only let me get dressed and go away for a few minutes till I can get dressed. So I built them a clinic. I hoped it would be a quiet place where I could write books. I have hardly written a single book because I've been busy transforming the gardens. I found such possibilities in the jungle for growing. That's how it happened. Nothing was ever planned. I always wanted it a place to conserve wildlife. I'd like every conceivable animal. I'd be like Noah with the Ark if I could. My critics, or people who don't like me, say I like animals because they can't talk back. No?
This Garden of Eden was created by trial and error and the bureaucratic consent of Latin American officials.
Each parrot had to have a passport given it by the Mexican consul in Guatemala. And I had four crates of orchids. They had to have passports too. And then I got on a train in Tapachula. The morning began badly. One parrot got sunstroke and died. I hadn't realized that parrots can't stand full sun for a long time. So I was feeling depressed, but I got the only drawing room on the back of the train, and I had four briefcases full of unfinished novels and poetry of travel and letters. And the van, which had the parrots, were right forward. The parrots and the orchids were in the sort of luggage van right at the top, at the head of the train. It meant walking down 12 cars between the passengers and calming the parrots and watering the orchids and coming back. The train stopped at every little station on the way. It even stopped at just crossroads where people came for half an hour and argued over the price of a turkey. And we were sometimes at least 35 minutes just at crossroads stops. So the journey from Tapachula to Tonala, which is only about 100 miles, took the entire day. And towards midnight, we were coming to Tonala. It's the only big town that we had approached. And the guard came and said, we're only staying 3 minutes in Tonala. You have to go and get your flowers and parrots off the train. You have to go up front because there won't be any porters. I said, only 3 minutes, but you were half an hour in the last farm you stopped. Why only 3 minutes? Oh, because it's muy noche. It's very late at night. We don't like to stay long in stations late at night. So I said, what nonsense? I said, will anybody get my bags off? No, 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 you have to do it yourself. So I thought, well, all my writing, years worth of writing of poetrums and 2 years worth of unfinished novels, I'd get those off first. So I got those in the doorway of the train, put them on the platform, and literally it was 2.5 minutes, the train was already moving. So I ran along, I had a very long beard, and I hadn't cut it down to here, very long hair, and was very disheveled, and I shouted, stop the train! My parrots are on it. The next stop was Veracruz. And of course, they would have died of thirst and starvation. And they said, no se puede, no se puede. We can't, we're on our way, we can't stop. And out of a clear sky, there was a terrific flash of lightning, not a cloud in the sky, and the biggest cap of thunder we've ever heard. And so the guard said to the engine driver, I think you better stop, he's a witch. Es un brujo. So the train stopped. And then all my parrots were handed out. Terrific cloudburst, the parrots handed upside down, but still alive. But it gave me a taste of the advantages of being a witch. Si, si, si. No quiere tomar un perito. No tiene...
Porque está... Now that he may count himself among their number, he feels it politic to remain on friendly terms with other local witches.
El blanco, ¿cuál de los dos le gusta lo más?
But it was a malicious act of God that prompted his most ambitious venture to date.
The building occurred only after the first 20 years here. The first 20 years I was solely interested in horticulture. And then suddenly, in 62, there was a snowfall. Nobody had seen snow before, didn't know what it was. So when I got back from New York a month later, they said, oh, Don Eduardo, for 3 days, white ashes fell and burned everything. So then I decided I would do something that couldn't be killed by freak weather. So I began building only then, things that looked like trees and plants and flowers. That was the result of the snow.
But the snow hardly accounts for the erection of Edward James's most ostentatious folly.
If I asked my heart and conscience, the incentive behind building a tower, I have to admit it was just pure megalomania. I think Aladdin's pantomime had something to do with it, because Aladdin's palace had towers and cupolas, rather like this. And then the shapes here, of course, are taken from the nature of the forest. They're sort of instinctively flower shapes and leaf shapes above all, which are inspired by everything round here. But of course, nothing is finished, so some of them look very odd. For instance, Plutarco calls those things helicopters, but they're going to actually turn into capitals. When it is 7 stories high, so now when it's 3 stories high, it's not even half what it's going to be, there's going to be a huge aviary on top with trees in it. That's why this is so terribly massive, because it's full of reinforced concrete, to stand live trees inside so the birds will really feel they're out of doors. Then we'll get all the wild parrots, and when they've bred enough, we let them out to multiply in the hills again. And there will be a room for projections and concerts. The principal thing, well, the tower will be an aviary with a many-sided object, dodecahedron, you know, the 12-sided object, which is in Leonardo's books on architecture. It'll go very slowly round like this, showing a different light. That'll be the top of all. That'll be the 8th floor.
30 workmen, craftsmen and labourers from the village are constantly employed, costing him, with building materials, $1,000 a week. And Edward has no architectural training.
I know nothing about engineering, so I have to use twice the amount of reinforcing steel than necessary in order to be sure they will stand up. In fact, I didn't know I had the capability of being an architect. I do rather clumsy sketches. I used to do rather more careful sketches. The great thing is having found Don Jose, because the previous carpenter never understood anything I drew. I do it a bit at a time, you see. If I said, now look, this is going to be like this, they'd forget it. So I say the next stage is we do this. The ideas come quicker than they could be executed, but I like to make a start on every idea, because then I don't forget it.
There are certainly aesthetic reasons, sometimes practical, for everything he builds, but as yet nothing is completed.
I mean, a lot will probably never be finished. I'd have to be 100 years old to finish them all. But then there's an Arabic proverb somebody once told me, never finish to build thy house, which means always keep on adding something. There's some Arab sage thought of that. I feel I can't be too dotty.
Mexico, tierra de amores y yo al cantar canción de México.
While collecting his animal kingdom, Edward James used to stop off in Mexico City at the Hotel Frances. Not the best in town, but the only one prepared to tolerate a menagerie in the bedrooms.
Buenos dias. Yes, it was owned by the same people who owned this Hotel Majestic, so they were very tolerant. In fact, the owner is a great friend of mine. He's called Don Jose Brockman, Swiss by birth, but he's been here all his life. And so the hotel practically would put up with anything. They were terribly nice. Sí. ¿Verdad? 1 year, you see, when my back was broken, I filled this whole suite with trees and pigeons and cockatoos. I also had a kinkajou, an ocelot, which is, you know, a little tiger, and a small monkey. And then another year, I found that I had to bring back some boa constrictors, and I got them up to my room, and they wouldn't eat. And so I got an extra suite that opened into mine just for the boa constrictors, but they still wouldn't eat. And then a very nice friend of mine went all the way to the market and got a lot of nice mice from Lagunilla in a sack, which looked very appetizing, because I was told the boa constrictors would only eat live things. Meanwhile, Leonora got me two beautiful rats from the laboratory. They'd all been combed and washed to look their best, because the laboratory thought she wanted to draw them. Well, the mice and the rats didn't like each other at all. And the boa constrictors wouldn't eat either. And the mice got out and ran along the corridor. And I don't know how, somebody must have left the door open. And one American lady, she was a Texan tourist, said, "My, there are mice in this hotel. This is disgusting. What the hell's happened in a hotel like this has mice?" And so the recamarera, the maid, said, "Oh, no, senora, they're not the hotel's mice. They have the food for the three boa constrictors in the next room to you."
Edward still makes periodic descents on his friends and protégés, most of whom now live in Mexico City. In this case, Leonora Carrington, an English painter, once the mistress of Max Ernst.
She said, and she meant limping. They never let you end in anthropology.
No, naturally.
You turn into carbon.
Se corrió el pobrecito. Se puso a correr. Se puso a correr, en serio.
Y mi mamá le gritaba, "Usted me ha embarazado." Did you hear that, Leonora?
No, she asked me why I wear two socks and two shoes. I had one foot is turning into a cloven hoof and the other into a parrot's claw.
Besides a testing but lasting friendship, Leonora shares Edward's love of cautionary verse.
It was called, what was it called? One about the Frigidaire. Do you remember?
Well, I remember the one about
when baby's cries were hard to bear, they popped him in the Frigidaire.
Yeah, that was...
My wife said, "George, I'm so unhappy. Our darling is now completely frappy."
Leonora Carrington's disturbing chimeras, bathed in a light that never was on land nor sea, attracted Edward James immediately. Long before she became fashionable in the States, and in consequence no longer dependent on his patronage, he had acquired more of her paintings than any other single person.
This picture by Leonora Carrington has never been exhibited, which I think it deserves to be, because it's one of her most imaginative. It's called Travelling Incognito. And the woman who is travelling incognito, as you see, has five eyes. There's a cat here who has only one eye. And the parrot is travelling in a fishbowl that has a pedestal with claws all around it. Then there's a normal cat there and a very strange parasol. And then the shape of the woman herself must be very extraordinary to necessitate such an odd drapery. The drapery of the lady inspired me to make a frame for it that was like an old-fashioned ball dress of black velvet.
His feeling for surrealism and early support for its struggling practitioners resulted in the largest personal collection of surrealist paintings.
I had no intention at all of making a collection. I just happened to know a lot of young, talented painters who, most of them were broke, because young artists, when they begin, have no following. They need money very much. So I began just buying paintings from them so as they could make a living and so they could continue their careers. I never bought pictures from indifferent or bad artists, at least none that I thought were bad, just to help them, because I don't think a bad artist should be encouraged. But there were real people of talent, like Chiriche, who really didn't know at the time where his next meal was coming, and I bought pictures from him and Dalí, who was doing all right, but he was not known. I went to his house in Spain and bought pictures from him when he was comparatively unknown. And Magritte was very poor at the time I first met him, too. He came and stayed with me in London all one summer and did the panels there. I only bought a few Picassos, because Picasso was already established, and he didn't need financial help. But I became a great friend of his. But I had no intention of making a collection. And I started being very surprised when I heard about the Edward James collection. I said, "What am I a collector? I didn't know that."
In fact, Edward valued the company of artists like Magritte as much as their work. This picture, painted while staying in Edward's London house, is one of Magritte's three psychologically apt portraits of Edward James himself. With Dalí, however, a long friendship turned sour after their final business deal.
At the end of the 1930s, I had a contract with Salvador Dalí to buy everything he painted for 1 year. Well, unfortunately, all the pictures remained in his studio until the outbreak of war. Finally, the pictures were sent by the packers to Bordeaux, where they were seized by the Germans. And I only got two back. This was one of them. It was on a train leaving Paris among the last loot, and the train was stopped, and the loot was that the Nazis were taking out of France was taken off it. And it had a bullet hole in it, which has been so well repaired, I can't see any signs of it. The picture represents swans, and their reflections form elephants, which, with the help of the trees behind, which make the legs of the elephants.
In 1964, he gave away the vast majority of his collection, together with Westdean House, its contents, and most of the estate, and created the Edward James Foundation. In accordance with his wishes, his old home has been converted into Westdean College, in the general view, an invaluable training school for the preservation of ancient crafts.
I wanted the survival of certain crafts that are dying out. No course for less than a year could produce a great craftsman. So the only long courses we've got are furniture restoration, which is run by the British Antique Dealers Association, and our tapestry course. But meanwhile, we have this hodgepodge of short courses, filling the place for weekends with people doing watercolours, and really, well, I think, rather rubbishy things.
Antique clock repairing is one of the few courses he endorses.
What is Sam doing?
Well, Sam is just putting the finishing touches to an English bracket clock that's virtually finished now.
Hmm. Is that the case for it?
Yes.
I wanted to set up a course for restoring valuable books. The other is a good stone carving course. You get people to do beautiful things in stone, and then a great wood carving course. That would be fulfilling a great national need. Uh-huh. You made it beautifully clean. Well, if there was room for another course, I'd like ironwork, making beautiful gates. We have an iron man, we have the foundry, but the most that anybody's ever produced is one poker. Yes, I'm disillusioned, because I think money's been thrown away on doing things of no importance. I got to the point in which I said, I gave my money to help humanity. I didn't give it to help elderly couples. Middle-class couples were bored watching television to learn how to make corn dolly or bobbin lace or perhaps find a book, paying less than they'd have to in an hotel in Torquay.
Disappointment and disillusion seem an integral part of this man, whose aspirations to high creative ideals are so often frustrated by his own complex and undisciplined personality. He seems happiest, perhaps, talking to his birds or tending his gardens. I wonder what less wealth and privilege would have made of Edward James.
I think I would have made a very good gardener if I'd had to earn a living, and I certainly would have been stuck with my nose to writing. And what is this? I dissipated everything. I've always been dashing around, building houses and travelling, so that I've had very little concentration to finish books, because supposing I hadn't been able to fulfil every kind of whim, and also getting interested in the work of other artists. And you're going to be able to continue the Laburnum Arch, and also having a lot of girlfriends who are actresses. I seem to have been stage struck. And I had to back shows for them on Broadway, or in London, or in Paris, which was very time-consuming and very wealth-consuming, too, because they were invariably a flop. They don't do that to children anymore nowadays. I have a great store of poetry, some of it printed already but never published, in suitcases and briefcases and vaults all over the world. In fact, it'll burst upon the astonished world someday.
get very lonely, do you?
Huh?
He gets very lonely. Poor Mr. Gong. He gets very lonely, don't you?
Huh?
I've known a lot of great eccentrics in my life. Take the Sitwells, for instance, particularly Edith. And I know that Edith didn't want to be an eccentric at all. She made an effort not to be. But it was her nature. And the same thing with me. I've never wanted to be an eccentric. In fact, I've tried to conform as much as possible, but something in my nature obliges me to be eccentric. And it's, people think, oh, he's a posing. He wants to make himself interesting. He's posing as eccentric. It's quite untrue. One is an eccentric, in this case, entirely against one's own will, one's own planning. It's just something that was born with, like having green hair. In fact, there was, a movie about it called The Boy with the Green Hair, showing that he couldn't help having green hair.
Nicht wahr, Anna? Ja, Anna.
Eagerly awaited series of Hancock's half-hour classic comedies. This week, The Blood Donor.
BBC Television presents...
Hancock.
Good afternoon. I've come in answer to your advert on the wall next to the Eagle Laundry in Pelham Road. An advert? Yes, your poster. You must have seen it. There's a nurse pointing at you. No, I believe she's a Red Cross lady, actually, with a moustache and a beard. It's penciled in, of course. You must know it. It's one of yours, definitely one of yours, next to Hands Off Cuba, just above the cricket stuff.